frequency is 3.8, and this is value 3.86. And now we start making our experimental Campbell diagram. This frequency here, as you can see here, is 3.87. I'll just put here. 3.87. That is easier. Start to rotate, and then we have to see the direction of the rotation. I have to make a mark. That's the angular velocity, positive direction. Start to rotate. Start to rotate. Just wait a little bit. Yes. Now, if I want to see, if I want to know, just put a little bit faster. Yes. If I want to know, what is the angular velocity of the system? What should I do with this device that I have? If I do not excite the system, I will not be able to see so much the natural frequency. I will only see one thing, is the permanent solution of the differential equation. The permanent solution is due to the imbalance. It means I have now a vibration, and this vibration is coming due to the imbalance. It means, if I come here, yeah, and I just reduce here the time to 10, because it takes 10 seconds, and if I just make this here to run, 10 seconds, I should be able to see by making a fast Fourier transformation of the vibration, of the angular velocity. So, that is here the angular velocity, yeah. And this angular velocity that I have is exactly this frequency here. And this frequency here is, I'll just put here, 20. Yeah. This frequency that you are seeing here for the imbalance is this frequency here of 8 hertz. It means the rotor is rotating with 8 hertz. I just go a little bit higher with the angular velocity, because this 8 hertz is also the natural frequency of the structure. As you can see here, the structure is vibrating with a couple of vibrations. I'll just put this a little bit higher. Yes. And then I'll do the test again, because now I will be able to see a new frequency that will be the new imbalance response. Then you can see how you can talk, yeah, by using signal processing and digitalization, help the information that you can get. And here you are having here, in x direction and y direction, and the rotor now is spinning with this frequency here of 14 hertz. That is this frequency here that I have here. That is the frequency that the rotor is spinning. Then I will come here and I'll make the first measurement. This frequency here is 14.7 hertz. And before I have one thing, what I'm going to do now, I'll put again here, 60 seconds. Why am I doing 60 seconds? If I do 60 seconds, I have a long period, I have a better resolution in the frequency domain. This delta F that you are being able to calculate with the fast Fourier transformation with this graphic here is strongly depending on where the period, T, the total time. If I take 60 seconds, the resolution in the frequency is 1 divided by this time. If I take 10 seconds, this 1 divided by 10 is 0.1 hertz. I want to get a very nice resolution, then I could hear 60. That's the reason why we wait a little bit longer. Then we wait a 60 seconds for this, and then what I'm going to do, I'll just come here and I come here with my finger, and I do this one here. What I did, the rotor is rotating with a little imbalance, and I just come here and just impact the rotor. What I do, I excite all the mode shifts in the natural frequency of the system. If the natural frequencies change, I will be able to see it, how take the signal in time and make a fast Fourier transformation. I can see what kind of frequencies I have. And that's what we're going to present in a couple of seconds. I can see here the angular velocity. Yeah, that is here. And what I can see here, I can see two frequencies. I can see this frequency here, that is 3.61. One of the natural frequencies becomes this one here, becomes 3.61. And the other one. This one here, 3.87. Okay. Because this comes here, and the other one becomes still here. Unfortunately. What I'm going to do now, another angular velocity. I mean, the class should stop now, but what I'm going to do is, let's finish the experiment, and then have 10 minutes break, and then just work with the program. Is okay?
Yeah.
Then I'll just... Faster? Okay. Now I can just put here 10 seconds, just for seeing what is the imbalance, what is the angular velocity. Wouldn't exciting? I just run here. 10 seconds, and then I should be able to see what is the frequency of the imbalance. Yes. Then, frequency is 34 hertz. That's this frequency here. That's the frequency that you can see here. This is 34 hertz. Now this is 34. And here is your angular velocity. So what I'm going to do now, I'll just take one minute, it runs, and then I come here and just give you an initial condition. Is 3.51. This here is your backward move, and this is your forward move. How have you seen the bone shapes for the structure? For the structure with 6 degrees of freedom, what we did? We had 6 natural frequencies, we did the model analysis. I took the shaker and just put the frequency of the shaker, exactly the frequency, the natural frequency of the system. And I could see how the mode shape would look like. What I'm going to do right now, I have an electromagnetic shaker here. And I can add a force that is exactly a sinus of excitation. And then what I'm going to do, I will select this frequency and this frequency. And you'll be able to see that this here, if the rotor is here, and rotates with this angular velocity, the cylinder here will rotate exactly in the opposite direction to make this movement here around. If I'm here and the rotor is rotating in this direction, yeah, that's the angular velocity of the rotor, this center here will make also orbit a resonance with a big amplitude, yeah, that will be the same direction of this. This will be your backward, and this will be your forward. Okay? Let's see that. It means, we have already calculated this one here. The angular velocity is the same. What I'm doing now is, I will select 3.1, 3.51, and 3.98. And then for the camera, I will be able to see that this point here will move the center, either this movement forward or this movement here backward. Even though the disc is rotating in this direction. Okay? That the first natural frequency is this one. And the backward is 3.52. 3.52. Then I come here. The center of the rotor, the movement of the center of the rotor. Can you see? The center of the rotor is moving in this direction. And the rotor is moving in this direction, the spin. That's your backward. Okay? Now what I'm going to do, if this is the backward, if I choose 3.8 hertz with the sinus, I should be able to see the other mode shape, and the other mode shape is the forward. And then I just put here 3.98. I come here, and I put here 3.98, and then enter. Power, because it's a resonance, yeah? Exactly. What I'm going to do now, I just put the forward, that is 3.8, with a lot of power. 3.98. Now you see what happens.
Wow.
Forward. That's the forward. Okay. And I'll put the back one again. 3.62. Enter. Crunch it. Now it's fast. In case you want to film it, I can just do that again. Forward and backward. And then we can put that. Okay. And the most important thing is, if you continue here with the higher law, this frequency is still changing. And when you have your balance, what do you do? You do this here. With your balance. And what you can see, for example, this rotor is met. What happens if I just turn off the shaker? Turn off the shape. There's no force anymore. It's only unbalanced. What I could do, I could try to increase the unbalance here, trying to see if I can see the backward or the forward. And you see that you can do whatever you want. If the system is symmetrical, the student computers are the same. When you run only with the balance, you only can see one critical speed. That is forward. I do this. I'll just reduce this here. I mean, the rotation is just transmitted by friction.
Yeah.
What I've been doing now, I've been just rotating, increasing the angular velocity now very, very slow. And you see that this boat will never ever rotate about with the backward. You'll be always forward, and then you have the resonance. You're very slow. This is very slow. You cannot see any kind of backward. Because if you see here, this big amplitude is just due to the imbalance. You are already here. And if you run a little bit fast, this amplitude reduces, and you don't have a backward. I'll just put this a little bit higher. You can see very clearly. The resonance frequency is is something around 0.87 and 9.9. 3.8 and 2.9. That's the where the natural frequency is. I mean, I should make this picture here a little bit more nice with a better resolution for seeing everything. But I mean, another thing that you could do, you could put one angular velocity and hit it, and then get this point. Another angular velocity hit in this and this, and you could get this completely stuck, and then you see, okay, you can just have a 45 degrees and know exactly where the resolution would be. Yeah. It's a little bit rough. But anyway, what you say then is 3.87 to 3.98. Oh, that's the range where this forward changed. It means when you cross this value here, it's something around this.
Oh, yeah.
It's a little bit less than 3.98, a little bit more than 3.87. That's what we can see in this table that we use. Okay?
So is it correct that the...
So in the red, in the program, this here in red means the forcing frequency. And this forcing frequency that you are using normally is your unbalance. If this here is your forcing frequency, that's the forcing frequency. And this frequency here is normally the unbalance, and what you say that is 1x. 1x means once, then another. This here, and then afterwards this one here. But there will be two elliptical orbits. One orbit will be in one direction forward, and another elliptical movement in this direction backward. But when it's circular, you just have one. It's then forward. If your excitation is the unbalance, it's very important to have in mind that when you excite, the system is rotating, and you excite, always have forward and backward from the transient solution. Because the forward and backward are two motions of the system. But when you have your imbalance, it's the forced vibration that you are looking at. And for the forced vibration, if you only have the unbalance and the system is symmetrical, you are not able to excite backward. You only excite forward. But if the system has some asymmetries, then we can excite both with the body. But the orbit has to be elliptical. Okay? If you look at the structure of the gyroscopic matrix, of the gyro, what you have for the disk, for example,
you have 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, omega 0, 0, 0.
And then you can see here, here is your d dot, dot dot, d dot, and gamma dot. That's the gyro effect. What the gyro effect does for you? The gyro effect here in the moment, in the main diagonal, is everything 0. The gyroscopic effect does not dissipate energy. What the gyroscopic does, if you have inclination, if you have angular velocities, yeah, what they do? They take the energy from one angle direction to the other one. When they take the energy from one direction and put it in another, this direction that gets the energy becomes softer. And the other that will take the energy up becomes more stiff. That's the reason why you have one that becomes softer and one that it was the physical explanation that grew also inside of the mathematical. But it's very important that the gyro has to be angular velocity. If you only have the translation, even though there's velocity, you don't have gyro. For having the gyro, you have to have this inclination here. And this test trick was especially designed for this, because you have a pivot point here, yeah, and the rotor has to have this inclination, beta dot and gamma dot. Okay? But before I do this experiment with the tape disc, my for seeing if first we have 3.87. And now what I'm going to do, I'll just take here from our program. Just A, B, C, 1, 9. For getting the natural frequency, what I should do? I should just come here. Stop. And come here and make this small perturbation.
And should the spreading of the lines be greater because the polar moment of inertia gets bigger?
Perfect. There's two things that you have to expect if you put a bigger disk. Put a bigger disk, you have more mass, this here should go down. And because you have a polar inertia that's bigger, now this opening here should be even more pronounced. Okay? It is what we're going to do experimentally now is the same test, yeah, where we're having here omega. Here we have the natural frequency is the imaginary part. Here is the imaginary part. Yeah. Assuming that it's not empty. Okay. Is it that? Yeah. This is that. Then if I go here, that's the excitation. I just come here and do here. Again. Then I can see that very, very clear. This. The first natural frequency now is 2.22. The new natural frequency when I add this is actually before was here, yeah, now it's here. And this frequency here is 2.23. Is 2.23. Everything here will give me in hertz. What I have to do now, put this to rotate. I mean, I tried this in my office, and this disc here start to get lost, loose, because it's screwed. And I have to be a little bit careful. As long as you hear that, you're not in a domino at all. The nominal velocity, there's no friction between the coupling and the point where you are connected. When this now it's rotating. What I should do, I just put here 10 seconds again, and then I only have the unbalance. Yeah, and with the unbalance, I should be able to define where I am in the Campbell diagram. I just did start with the measurements, 10 seconds, and I'll just have a sinus. Yeah, this is the two sinus here, the natural frequencies and the unbalance. But then if I put here for example, now 18 hertz, I'm glad I lost it. I can put here what I am. Instead of having here as I was before, I'm a little bit here. This here is where I'm measuring. 18 hertz. 18 point something. 18. Okay, that's the new experiment that we have. 18. Now, what I'm going to do with this angular velocity, I'll just put it here 60. But then I have a very good resolution in the frequency domain. Yeah? And I do this one here. very low depth. We have the magnetic forces. The magnetic forces process mostly the synthesis. We just have friction with the air and friction in the coffee. Then we wait 1 minute. We do that again. Then we have a quick break. Yes.
And I remember that you said when the red line cross the curves, then we have natural frequencies, right?
We have critical speeds. And this critical speeds means resonances. Because, I mean, what is the difference between exciting a structure and excite a rotor in resonance? The natural frequencies of the structure does not change with the angular velocity. And then you know where they are and you just excite them. For exciting the resonance of the rotor, you have to know where the natural frequencies are because they are depending on the angular velocity. You change the angular velocity, you change the natural frequency.
Then here, the natural frequency is 2.23. But the resonance should be lower.
This here is 2.23 in both directions with angular velocity zero. But at the moment that you have the angular velocity, these natural frequencies change. And now, for example, we have 18 hertz. You just perturbate the system that will vibrate the natural frequencies. And what we can do now, we can come here, now after this excitation, and put it here, for example, 20. And we can easily see here two frequencies. And I'll just reduce this. I'll just reduce a little bit more. This one here. Five. Yes. That is the two natural frequencies. The first natural frequency now is 1.88. First natural frequency here now is 1.88. 1.88. And the second natural frequency, this one here, is 2.63. This here, much more than this one here, because this is bigger. If you want, I can make one test more. Could I? Not necessary. But one thing I can do, just take the shaker and excite in this frequency and this frequency, so you can see forward and backward. It's still the same. Then I'll put 1.88 and 2.63. The first excitation that I will put here is the backward, that is 1.88, and then I'll just reduce it here to 0, and then I start the shape. Doing now, I'll put the backward 1.88, transient, and then backward, transient, now back. student, and I had the first class in Global Dynamics where everything was explained about forward and backward, I always think about how can it be. And when this little test week was built, and I started making all preparation for the class, and we could see easily with the eye and with the camera this forward and backward. When you are here, your rover is here, yeah, and your orbit will be in that direction. If the rover is rotating, for example, in this direction, the orbit will be in this direction. And here, for example, if the rover is rotating in this direction, the orbit on the center will be in this direction. Okay. Good. But I think that for today is what I have to show. And now we have a 10-minute break.